हेलो, दिस इज डॉक्टर सी एल पाटिल, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश, सी कैब, ए आर एस इनामदार, आर्ट साइंस एंड कॉमर्स कॉलेज एंड पीजी सेंटर फॉर वेमेन, विजयपुर। आई एम गोइंग टू प्रेजेंट ए फ्यू कॉमेंट्स ऑन The excerpts of Pampa's epic Adi Purana, referring to Bharata Bahubali confrontation. Adi Kavi Pampa is the Jain poet of 9th century, known for his two great epics, Vikramarjuna Vijaya and Adi Purana. The epic Adi Purana is written in Champu style, a mixed form of prose and verse. It has 16 cantos. It deals with the life of Lord Adinatha, the first Tirthankara of this era, and his sons Bharata and Bahubali. The life of Adinatha and his previous 10 births become the subject matter of this epic. It also contains a detailed description of the social, religious, and economic lives of the people of his era. The epic throws light on ancient Indian geography, astronomy, astrology, music, musical instruments, dance, customs, traditions, and warfare. The theme of this epic is attainment of mukti, liberation, eternal salvation. Adinatha was known as King Rishabhadeva. Before his renunciation of worldly life, he had married two wives. By his first wife, Sumangala, he had 99 sons, of whom Bharata was the eldest, and a daughter, Brahmi. By his second wife, Sunanda, he had a son, Bahubali, and a daughter, Sundari. All these children were trained in different arts and crafts. Bharata became a great warrior and a politician. So, Bahubali. Because Bahubali was tall, well-built, and strong, he was called Bahubali. Rishabhadeva ruled a vast kingdom. At the time of his renunciation, he made Bharata the ruler of Vinita, also known as Ayodhya, and Bahubali the ruler of Takshashila. To the remaining 98 sons, he distributed his vast kingdom. Bharata was an ambitious ruler and established his control over Vinita within a short period and intended to become emperor of the entire nation. Therefore, he organized a strong army and developed different types of weapons. He possessed an incredible wheel called Charakaratna that never missed the target. In a short span of time, he easily conquered all the surrounding rulers around Vinita. Then he turned his interest towards his 98 brothers and asked them to admit his superiority. They all went to their father, Lord Rishabhadeva, to seek advice. He explained them about conquering their inner enemies, that is, inner passions and not the external. He also advised them on achieving mukti, eternal salvation, which is a true kingdom. They all understood the futility of fighting and surrendered their regions to him, rejected all worldly pleasures, and became followers of Lord Rishabhadeva. But Bahubali did not surrender. He was conscious of his rule. The kingdom handed over to him by his father, he thought was right to rule. Besides, he had the will and capacity to fight any invader. Therefore, when he received Bharata's appeal to accept a subordinate status, he refused and was prepared to fight. Everyone thought the war between the two brothers will result in major bloodshed, death, and disaster. Therefore, the early efforts made by the counselors to stop the war were in vain. War appeared inevitable, and both the brothers brought their armies face to face on the battlefield. Everyone trembled at the tragic result of this war and the death and disaster that it would bring. Finally, the counselors were successful in explaining to their masters that the main point of the conflict was to determine which brother was superior. Instead of war, a fight between the two brothers would easily settle the matter and would prevent necessary bloodshed, death, and disaster. Both brothers agreed, and rules were framed, and they must engage in a duel, and the victor would be accepted as the leader. On the day of the duel, Bharata's attempts to defeat Bahubali with various weapons were in vain. Bharata thought that his defeat in the hands of the brother would be shameful and terrible. His ambition to rule the entire world would be in vain, and his defeat intolerable. Bharata grew wild, violated the rules of the duel by releasing his miracle wheel, the Charakaratna, at Bahubali. Bharata could not harm and injure Bahubali because he forgot that this miracle weapon, Charakaratna, would not harm any blood relatives. At this, Bahubali became furious because Bharata violated the rules of the duel. He thought of smashing Bharata with his mighty fist. As he rose his hand, people trembled at the thought of Bharata's impending death. Suddenly, a flash of insight came to Bahubali and thought, "What am I doing? Have I gone mad? Am I going to kill my elder brother for the sake of some worldly pleasures, possessions that the respected father had discarded and which his 98 brothers had given up?" He trembled at the possibility of death of Bharata, his brother. He changed his mind. He saw the evil in killing a brother he respected. Instead of bringing down his hand to hit his brother, he used it to pull on his hair as a symbol of giving up everything and all the worldly pleasures of life, a renunciation ceremony celebrated among the Jains. But Bahubali, a man of pride and ego, understood that if he went to his father and stated his intention of renunciation, then he should be obedient to his 98 younger brothers who were senior to him in monkhood, which for him was unacceptable. Bahubali decided to seek enlightenment on his own and started meditating on the very spot where he stood. He became so engrossed in his meditation that he could not remember how long he had stood there, because creepers had grown around his feet. Yet he could not gain enlightenment. He could not because he had not given up his ego. Realizing this, Lord Rishabhadeva sent his daughters Brahmi and Sundari to bring him to the right path. They came to the place where Bharata wanted to fight and saw Bahubali in meditation standing like a rock. They peacefully told him, "You cannot get enlightenment while sitting on an elephant. You need to get off the elephant." As their familiar voices reached Bahubali's ears, he opened his eyes in astonishment, looked around, but he did not find himself on an elephant. He realized that the elephant they were referring to was his ego. He immediately melted away his ego and decided to go to Lord Rishabhadeva and was ready to bow to his 98 brothers. During his long penance, he had conquered all other corrupt passions except ego, which still remained between him and enlightenment. But later, after giving up his ego, he became very humble. And as he took the first step towards Lord, he achieved full enlightenment and omniscient. It is said that Bahubali became the first person who attained liberation in this era as per the Digambara sect.